I'm going to invite next Patrik Lantto to speak with us. Patrik is director of the Center for Sami Research and associate professor of history in the Faculty of Arts at Umea University, Umea, Sweden. Dr. Lantto's area of expertise include the history of the Sami people, indigenous history, Swedish political history, and the history of education. He has been a visiting professor and guest speaker at York University, Toronto, Canada, the Hawke Research Institute, University of South Australia, Adelaide, and Smithsonian Institute in Washington, D.C. He very graciously accepted my invitation to come. Patrik, I'm so happy to have you. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle, and thank you for the invitation to come here and speak. First of all, I'd also like to offer my respect and acknowledge the original people here of this land. I can only underscore how important more knowledge is on indigenous issues. My university campus, for example, is on traditional Sami land. It was used as reindeer grazing land after World War II, before the university was built. And I would bet you that 99.9% of the students in Umeå don't know that fact, for example. Let's just see if I can find my presentation as well. Should be somewhere here. Here we go. And second of all, I also have to warn you, I'm going to talk about history, not just because I'm a historian, but a little bit because I'm a historian. But you have to understand the history of the Swedish Sami policy to understand the situation today. If you don't, you're handicapped. You cannot get to the bottom of why issues are so complex and so sensitive if you don't know the history. And unfortunately, many people don't know the history at all, especially among the politicians and the civil servants in Sweden, which is a problem. But if I say Sweden, if you think about Sweden, what do you think about then? What image do you have of Sweden? In my opinion, Sweden has a very well earned, well-deserved reputation of working internationally on for the rights of people who are subordinate. They work on the rights for women, for gay and lesbians, for minorities, and also for indigenous peoples. But the situation compared to how Sweden looks at these issues nationally is quite different, however. It's a very different thing when you look at Sweden's work in their own state. I just wanted to start off by giving you a kind of a geographical frame for where I am at. Here you have one of the many different maps showing the Sami territory. This is, there are many different versions of where the borders are, because Sapmi is a borderless territory. So you can't really fix it on a map. But this is generally what you talk about when you talk about Sapmi. And as you can see, it's partitioned between four different states today: Norway, Sweden, Finland, and Russia. The number of Sami is anybody's guess. The estimates vary between 70,000, perhaps 100,000, even up towards 300,000. But we simply do not really have a number, because the Nordic states haven't registered ethnicity or race since 1945. So we don't know how many people actually consider themselves to be Sami today. Just wanted to show you a second map as well. These are the three northernmost counties in Sweden where you have most of the reindeer herding going on. I'm going to speak a little bit, mention them from time to time, so I thought you should see where they're at. Norrbotten, Västerbotten, where my university is, Umeå, you can see there on the map, and Jämtland. There is also reindeer herding going on to the east of these counties and a little bit to the south, and some reindeer herding districts also have summer grazing land on the Norwegian side of the border. So why am I talking so much about reindeer herding? Well, that is something that my presentation will explain, especially when I talk about the history before I come to the situation more today. This is where the foundation of reindeer herding's place in the Swedish Sami policy is made. Just briefly, I'm just going to talk about the 130 years, so it's not long history, really. It's really a short period. But up until 1886, the Swedish state treated the Sami more or less like a people. They were not, of course, an equal partner. This changed successively, coming closer to modern times. They became more and more subordinate in the Swedish system. But they were treated more or less like a people. There were an ethnic component in the church records in Sweden that was based on your profession. So if you were, you know, hunting, fishing, or herding reindeer, you would be registered as a Sami, or Lapp, as they were called in Sweden back then. But if you started up with agriculture, you would be registered as a Swede. But this did not affect their rights to the land, and it did not mean automatically that people would change their identity. So they were treated more or less as a people. But from 1886, we have one livelihood only to determine who was a Sami, and that was the reindeer herding. The Swedish Sami policy became kind of fixated on this image of the Sami as herders during the end of the 19th century. There was a view of the Sami as herders, a view of them as both physically and psychologically adapted to this specific industry, this specific livelihood, and this specific animal. As you can see by the quotation by Bishop Olof Bergqvist in 1907. This is kind of the idea that was a central part of the Sami policy, which was being formulated during the late 19th century. And this focus on the Sami as herders, that only nomadic reindeer herders were genuine Sami, meant that other aspects of Sami culture and livelihoods were marginalized and in the end excluded. And this is what I mean, that only one livelihood were used to define Sami identity. All Sami outside of reindeer herding were now being excluded from the Sami context, excluded from having any rights to the land, and many also, of course, changed identity because of this, because of the exclusion from Sami context. But the Sami as a group, and that is in the eye of the state, the reindeer herders were considered to be threatened by the contacts with the superior Swedish culture. And this was something that was seen to be demoralizing to the Sami. There was a fear that this would take the Lapp out of the Lapp, as the saying was at this time. There are similar sayings there in North America, I understand. And this was seen as very serious, since there was a fear that if the Sami stopped being reindeer herders, the Sami people and culture would cease to exist. This was kind of also a fundamental part of the base of the Swedish Sami policy. So the Sami policy was actually aimed at preserving the Sami unchanged. But this was according to a very normative image of a male mountain Sami herder with a nomadic lifestyle. And the Swedish authorities tried to force all Sami herders into this mold. Very strongly romanticized Swedish image, I would want to underscore, of reindeer herding and Sami culture. They actually tried to teach the Sami how to herd reindeer right. They actually tried to teach the Sami what was genuine Sami culture. They actually tried to do this, which is interesting in itself. We also had a legislative framework for this with the Reindeer Grazing Acts. The first one came in 1886, and then the two followed in late 19th century and early 20th century. This first Reindeer Grazing Act did not state outright that the Sami were reindeer herders, but the focus on this specific livelihood made it very clear that the others became successively defined out from this context. And this has had very deeply felt effect on the Sami people, both historically and today. Sami who were not reindeer herders then lost their rights. And this is something that is very open sore in Sami society today, the haves and have-nots. It's a very big problem. And the right to hunt and fish is a big part of the rights of the herders. Perhaps I will also mention what these Sami rights actually are, because they're not land rights as indigenous peoples in other countries perhaps have. The right the Sami have as an indigenous people in Sweden is the right to herd reindeer, to hunt and to fish, and to some extent use the forest. So they don't have any actual right to the land. They have the right to use the land. And the act, this first reindeer grazing act, also created the kind of the administrative framework for reindeer husbandry in Sweden today, with the reindeer herding districts. It was also a very important instrument for control over the Sami. That is something that hasn't been focused on too much in research, but it's very clear from the way they talk about the act and the way they worked with it, that this was an instrument to control the Sami, to lead them in the right direction, because they needed to be led, according to the view. There isn't really much to say about the Act of 1898, apart from that it strengthened the possibilities for the authorities to actually control reindeer herding. In the Reindeer Grazing Act of 1928, finally, we got the definition then of who was a Sami in the eye of the law. And it was then, quote, "The right to reindeer herding belongs to persons of Lapish descent, if his father or mother or any one of their parents pursued reindeer herding as a permanent profession or assisted within this profession," end of quote. So now you have finally a definition which kind of finalized the development you had had since 1886 of excluding the Sami who weren't reindeer herders. But to be allowed to exercise these rights, you had to be a member of a reindeer herding district, which is also a central part of the Swedish Sami policy today. We also had a specific administration for these issues, the Lap administration, created from 1885 and onwards. And this administration, you can compare it to the Bureau of Indian Affairs, the Department of Indian Affairs here in North America, but it's also very different in many senses. But it was an important power when it came to the Swedish Sami policy. From very early on, the Lap bailiffs, as they were called, who led the work of the Lap administration, were considered to be the foremost experts on Sami issues in Sweden. So they got to give their opinion on almost anything. They, for example, decided who among the Sami would get poor relief. They decided which Sami could get a gun license. They decided how big, or even if, they were going to get any liquor ration during the period we had rationing of liquor in Sweden. They affected almost all aspects of daily life for the Sami, especially for the herders, but they also affected the lives of the non-herding Sami, even though they really weren't part of this political area. And from the 1910s, this authority, the Lap administration, started to grow with more positions being created. And it was incredibly strong during the interwar years between the First and Second World War. And they had a very strong influence on maintaining the Swedish Sami policy unchanged because of their positions as the foremost experts in the state system. They started to lose kind of their power in the after the Second World War, but this is a slow process. So it existed up until 1971 and this administration. In the period after World War II, things start to change quite a lot. The Lap administration, as I mentioned, lost some of its control over the Sami and could never regain that control, and became more and more questioned by the Sami movement in Sweden. The Sami movement had been, you know, slowly growing during the first half of the 19th century or the 20th century, but it's after the war and with the creation of the first national Sami organizations after the war that it really breaks out onto the political scene and becomes an actor within the Sami political system, so to speak. And they criticized the lab administration relentlessly until the state finally in 1971 closed down the authority because they realized it was impossible to uphold this. But also, we have a new legislation in 1971, which was the Reindeer Husbandry Act. And what's interesting is that this new legislation gave the reindeer herding districts a more independent position, more or less, than they had before. And at the same time, then, the lab administration was closed down. So it would seem that Sweden took a big step forward when it came to the Sami policy at this time. But what really happened, for example, with the lab administration is that all the civil servants from this authority was moved over to the new authority given responsibility for these issues. And if you have the same people, even though you change the house, you have the kind of structures, the ideas, they remain. And people still feel that they can kind of hear the lab administration when they speak to the reindeer herding administration of today. And the new act of 1971 also kind of limited what the herding districts can do. They are, for example, not allowed to pursue any other economic interests apart from reindeer herding. They were only allowed, the district is only allowed to work on reindeer herding. They can't start a business working with tourism, for example. They're not allowed to do anything else apart from herding reindeer. The individuals in the herding districts can, of course, start companies if they want to, but to have the economic resources of the district behind a project like that would, of course, strengthen these issues. So it's modern on the surface, and it's an improvement on the surface, but still it's kind of business as before in Sweden. And we also have the recognition of the Sami as an indigenous people in 1977 by the Swedish Parliament, even though that's somewhat questioned today, I would say. But this is the latest, biggest developments, I would say, in the Swedish Sami policy. Because what's happened since is that we've been treading water, more or less. We had this big government bill, big in Sweden, government bill in 1993, which it looked at reindeer herding. It now describes it as a collective right that belongs to all the Sami. The entire Sami people have the right to herd reindeer. Of course, you have to be a member of the reindeer herding district to be allowed to do this, which means that it's no change at all. But now it's a right that belongs to the entire people. We also had the creation of a Sami parliament and a legal definition of who had the right to register to vote for this Sami parliament. So now we have a different definition of who is a Sami, and it's based on language skills. But it's still a two-generation thing, as you saw, heard mention about the Reindeer Grazing Act. It's Sami have to have been spoken by. It has to be spoken by you, or have been spoken by your parents or your grandparents. And with the educational policy having been what it's been, it's not at all a certainty that Sami have their languages. Especially in the southern areas, many have lost their language several generations back, and they're not allowed to vote for the Sami parliament. In Norway, they have a three-generation rule. So it's a difference. And the Sami parliament also is a state authority. So this also quite strongly limits what the parliament can do and can't do. So someone who gets elected to the Sami parliament on a platform that is very critical of the Swedish Sami policy, for example, can't really do what they want to do when they are elected, because the Sami parliament as a state authority has to be neutral. It has to support the Swedish state and the Swedish Sami policy. So they can't really do what they want to. So it's really, that's why I say that the Swedish Sami policy hasn't really developed since the 1970s, because the Sami parliament, even though important, and even though symbolically very, very a big issue, it has so limited power to work. And it has a very, very limited economic framework as well. It's about, next year's budget is a little bit less than $5 million US dollars. And you can't really do very much with that kind of funding. That's also something the Swedish state does very, very well. And finally, we had expanding hunting and fishing in Sami, in Sápmi through this act. And this is a big issue today, I can tell you. The Swedish state really hadn't claimed to have any right to hunting and fishing as a landowner before 1987, when they made it really stake the claim on that issue. But already here in 1993, they exclude the reindeer herding districts from having any say in who could get a license to hunt and fish. So something the Sami, the reindeer herding Sami always had as a right to be a part of the process of granting licenses to hunt and fish for other people. But now they lost that position in 1993 because the state saw this as a possible moneymaker. This is in the 2 years before, I think, the Swedish referendum on joining the EU, for example. And it's not a coincidence. We had a Swedish government committee working on the issue of the ILO Convention number 169 concerning the rights of indigenous peoples. And in 1990, Sweden had declined to ratify the convention because the way land rights were described in the convention was considered to be incompatible with Swedish legislation back then. But this committee, the ILO committee, in its report, concluded that Sweden in many instances did comply with the ILO convention, but had to solve a number of issues with the Swedish legislation to be completely compatible with the convention. But the committee thought that the ratification would be possible within 5 years if we solved some of the central issues, which was to identify traditional Sami land, to clarify the extent of Sami hunting and fishing rights. Here we go again with the hunting and fishing. Also improve the protection of reindeer herding rights and also strengthening of the Sami parliament's position and power. This committee also suggested that the Swedish state should economically guarantee the costs for court cases that had a big symbolic importance for Sami rights. But that has not been carried through, and neither has any of these other suggestions from the committee. Because in Sweden, there's one thing we do well, it's appoint government committees, let them work, and then put their work on the shelf and never talk about it again. So we had four committees working the last decades on the issues specifically pointed out by the previous committee that were central to solve, enable it in order to make Sweden able to ratify the ILO convention. We had a conventional committee on reindeer husbandry, one on the Sami parliament, one on hunting and fishing, one on traditional lands. And none of these huge reports have led to any political decisions in Sweden. There's so many man hours that have been wasted on this. And of course, if we want to do something now, we have to have new committees. So. Sweden is very far from ratifying the ILO convention, I can tell you that. But there is another interesting development. Well, a few other. I should mention that the Sami today are also recognized as one of five national minorities in the country, which gives them certain language rights. But I will also say that this is a very big problem because this has made the Sami more invisible in, for example, curricula, as most of the demands in the curricula are talking about national minorities and not specifically mentioning the Sami or indigenous people. So that means that students in Sweden today do not learn very much about the Sami, if anything. And that is true for the university system as well, unfortunately. You can have a teacher, the people taking teacher education at my university, for example, most of them never hear a word about the Sami. And this is the university that has most scholars working on Sami issues. We have the only center for Sami research. We have the most focus of all universities in Sweden on these issues. and still this does not translate into the educations that we give, which is very unfortunate. We also have a Nordic Sami Convention discussion going on. There was a draft convention presented in 2005, and in true Swedish and Nordic fashion, we dropped it for a few years, not wanting to really discuss these issues because they're difficult. In 2011, they started up negotiations again, and they are actually talking about that a new proposal should be presented this year. It's not much left of this year, so I'm not really that hopeful, but they are negotiating and they are talking about that something should come out, which is interesting because this, I think, a Nordic Sami Convention, in my view, is the only thing that can kickstart the Swedish Sami policy system, because the Swedish politicians on their own won't do that. But if we get a Nordic Sami Convention, which is based on a higher standard than Sweden holds today when it comes to indigenous issues, this would be very important. And in 2010, the Sami were recognized as a people in the Swedish constitution. But this should be huge, but it has led to, so far, no changes in Sweden either. I don't think everyone in Sweden realized how big this issue is, that the Sami are recognized as a people, actually, in the constitution. So what happens when you can't work through issues politically? Well, the Sami movement have had a few strategic, huge court cases that they've been working in. The Sami movement have been a very active actor in this field. They've been very active trying to reform the political system from within. From the 1950s and onwards, the Sami movement has been a very, very strong actor and has forced the Swedish Sami policy to change in some issues in some instances. But it can only do so much when the political system starts to kind of become unwilling and unable to act at all. So court cases has become an alternative. And this is big in Sweden because in the Swedish legal system, the courts don't have the same active role as they have here in North America. They don't bring forth new legislation. This is supposed to be happening through the political system. So we have these four big court cases. Skattefjällen or the tax mountain case was about ownership to land in Jämtland, the southernmost of the three counties I showed you, which the Sami, after 15 years, lost. But it strengthened the position and rights of reindeer herding, this verdict of the Supreme Court in 1981, which was important, has been important in itself. The two in between, Härjedalen and Nordmaling, are court cases about traditional grazing rights on privately owned land, which the Sami herding communities have. And in Härjedalen, the Sami lost, which was a huge blow to some of the more southern herding districts in Sweden. In Nordmaling, they actually won. This is the first big court case that the Sami in Sweden have actually won. And this in itself shows that the courts are starting to change the way they view the Sami position, Sami rights, and their own role in looking at Sami issues. And the Girjas case is ongoing. And this also is an indicator of how the role of the courts is changing in Sweden. And this is about hunting and fishing rights. Where the state claimed to have the right as a landowner, while the reindeer herding district Girjas claimed to have an exclusive right to hunting and fishing that the state doesn't have at all. And I've been a part of this court case, and it's been really interesting to follow. Girjas is one of these reindeer herding districts which was formed in 1887 after the first Reindeer Grazing Act. You can see it up here in blue. This is their year-round land, which is marked in blue. They also use land to the east of that during the winter time. It's an area of about 3,562 square kilometers, and I included square miles for those of you who feel uncomfortable with the metric system. So it's a fairly big area. In 2009 then, the Girjas herding district, together with the Swedish Sami Association, which is one of the national Sami organizations, they sued the state, claiming that the Girias, the reindeer herding district, had exclusive rights to hunting and fishing, or at least that this right was shared with the state. And that would mean that they would become, again, a part of the process of deciding who would be granted licenses for hunting and fishing. The state, of course, denied this claim by the reindeer herding district. And they also argued that the Sami actually hadn't used this land for a very long time. The state, the Sami side talked about, or based their claim on use from time immemorial, whilst the state said that there had been very little Sami activity in the Girjas area before the middle of the 18th century. And yeah, well, you can't see it. I can show you the map again. This is a central part of the Sami area. A central part in Sweden, but a central part of Sapmi as a whole. So this claim that the Sami hasn't been present to any greater extent until middle of the 18th century is just an incredible claim to be made by the Swedish state. They're actually kind of questioning more or less the Sami as an indigenous people. And they also, of course, claim that hunting and fishing isn't really that important to reindeer herding Sami, even though it's always been a very important complementary part of their economy. And especially important during bad years for reindeer herding, when you lose a lot of animals, hunting and fishing becomes absolutely crucial for survival. So in a case like this, generally the burden of proof would fall on the plaintiff and not the defendant, so on the reindeer herding district more or less. But the court, in this case, recognized the huge difference in strength between the two parties. I mean, you have on the one hand a small reindeer herding district with very limited economic resources versus the state with almost unlimited economic resources. And as I mentioned, the state in Sweden does not guarantee the costs for court cases like this. So it's a big economic gamble to pursue this strategy for the Sami society and for the reindeer herding district in this case. I think their cost for the first part of the trial has been 7.5 million Swedish krona, which is a little bit less than $1 million. And I can assure you they don't have that money. And most of the documentation used in the case as evidence is, of course, created by the state to support the interests of the state. So it's very biased against the Sami, of course. But despite this, the court did not choose to place the burden of proof on the state as the defendant, but rather that each party had to substantiate their own arguments. So that was at least to some extent a relief for the Sami side. So that was the main base for the case. And it was brought before the district court finally in 2015. This is the first instance of the Swedish court system, the district court. The state actually tried to prevent the case from going to court and had kind of an obstructionist policy in politics in the beginning, which of course makes the case more expensive and more risky for the Sami side. But there was also some remarkable things that were being said both in the court by the lawyers representing the state and by state representatives outside the court. One thing the lawyer said was that Sweden had no international obligations to admit special rights for the Sami, whether or not they were an indigenous people. I mean, Sweden has signed a number of conventions that actually they have international obligations to, according to, and this almost questioning of the Sami as an indigenous people is also very interesting. Another statement was that basically all modern research concerning Sami issues, and thus all active researchers in the field, apart from those that they themselves used, of course, are prejudiced, or have the aim to, quote, emphasize and support Sami interests and claims, as it was stated by the lawyers. And the goal is to promote Sami interest, and that goal is more important than good research and good research ethics, according to the state lawyers looking at this. The big problem, of course, was that they couldn't really find support for their arguments in research made from the 1980s and onwards. But this is the argument they made. This led to a debate article signed by 59 of my colleagues in Sweden, really aggressively criticizing the state for this kind of argument. And the 59 researchers also reacted to the use of the term LAP by the lawyers representing the state. As I mentioned, LAP was what the term historically used in Sweden concerning the Sami. It started to change in the 1950s in the more official language use in state authorities. They started to talk about Sami. But up until then, LAP had been used. And it is seen as derogatory by many Sami. So it's a very big problem. But the state lawyers, they argued that LAP was not used to define an ethnic group in the historical material. It was not, therefore, the same thing as Sami is today. It was used, they argued that it was used kind of to define their profession in the historic material. And as a consequence, they decided to only use the term LAP throughout the entire court negotiations. Which, of course, was something that many people reacted incredibly negatively to. And the Attorney General, Anna Skarhed, in Sweden, when asked about the choice, the choice to speak only about the LAP, only use the term LAP, for example, stated in an interview that, quote, "You're only Sami if you decide to be. Everything is a play with words," end of quote. This is the Attorney General of Sweden, who saw the whole discussion as out of proportion and irrelevant, and who really, really lacked the ability to see the negative connotations it had for the Sami. And the district court actually, interestingly, took a stand on this issue with reference to the fact that Sami, since the beginning of the 20th century, had argued for that they should be called Sami. They stated that they would use the term throughout their verdict, except from when quoting old sources, of course. So they took a stand and kind of gave a nudge to the Swedish state that this wasn't really, really good. And the Swedish state, I should say, the case is being prepared for the next level, the Court of Appeals, and the Swedish state actually have learned now. They talk about Sami in that material. But the verdict then was that Girjas has actually exclusive rights to hunting and fishing in its area. This was the verdict of the state. The verdict of the court, and that the state had no right to hunting and fishing and thus have no right to grant licenses to hunt and fish, which is a huge development. If this would stand in the Court of Appeal and in the Supreme Court, this will be something that affects the Swedish Sami policy. And it'll be very interesting to see how the state reacts if they would indeed lose this case, because this is one of 51 reindeer herding districts in Sweden. Will the Swedish state, if they lose, accept this as something that should be applied in the entire area, or will the Sami be forced to sue them again with another district? This is not clear at all at this point in time. And the court also rejected forcefully the timeline of the Swedish state concerning Sami presence. They talk about Sami presence for more than 1,000 years. And they also, very interestingly, say that the Swedish state cannot have become owners of this land until 1887, which is quite different from previous state views on this issue. And this could come into play if the Sami want to challenge the state ownership to the land in the future. But it's also been a very controversial verdict in Sami society, since it's seen as there's a further consolidation of the rights of the reindeer herders. This is less than 10% of the Sami population in Sweden today are a member of a reindeer herding district. And as I mentioned, they are the only ones who have the right to herd reindeer and to hunt and to fish. And there is a concern that this will lead to a strengthening of those that already have rights and that those who are outside won't get anything. Even the president of the Sami parliament in Sweden expressed his misgivings about this, the verdict of the court, which is in itself a huge news. His party represents non-reindeer herding Sami, so in a way it's not surprising, but it's still that the Sami parliament doesn't feel positive about a court case where the Sami side wins is something that's very interesting. Next year it will be heard before the Court of Appeals and we'll see what happens then. But unless the negotiations concerning the Nordic Sami Convention can lead to actual changes in the Swedish Sami policy, the courts seem to be the only way for the Sami to actually move forward when it comes to their rights. The only avenue the Sami movement right now have. But it's a highly risky strategy, not least economically, as I mentioned, as there are no state guarantees concerning the costs. And if you wonder who the photographer is who's taken the pictures that I've shown you on the last few slides, very beautiful pictures, they're all from Girjas, the Girjas case and Girjas area. It's this guy up here, Matti Berg, who is the chairperson of the Girjas reindeer herding district and a good friend of mine. And I think I'll settle for that. Thank you. Used some archaeological research to put their claims forward, but they have a very slim sector, part of the sector that actually support their claim that it wasn't Sami who were present in this area historically. So the huge part of research, archaeological research, actually support that this is Sami, that the remains that have been found, that there is a huge system of pits that were used for hunting, for example. That they drove the animals into these pits. The state tried to claim that this isn't a Sami, but most of the research on this is supporting the Sami side. But it's a complex picture.
I'm wondering. Whose original right it is to decide that Sami identity is directly tied specifically to reindeer herding? Whose original idea was that? And has it been challenged from whence that person has the authority or right to make that determination as opposed to Aboriginal title and Aboriginal presence?
Well, that began as a part of the Swedish, when the Swedish policy started to define itself more clearly concerning Sami issues, that's where you have the idea of the herders as the only Sami, and then that became part of the Swedish culture. If there's anything a Swede knows about the Sami today, and that's generally very little, he connects them to reindeers, for example, that they're reindeer herders. And what's happened then with the Sami movement when it became stronger and more visible during the post-war era was that it based itself, the first big national Sami organization based itself on Sami, local Sami associations and the reindeer herding districts. And this organization exists today still, and it more or less represents the herders and their interests. And for them, there is a fear that improved rights or rights to the Sami that don't have rights right now will mean that they will lose rights. So they are kind of part and parcel of being really skeptical about changes and how that will affect their situation. And the Sami outside, of course, want to have a different view. They want to be part of having Sami rights, because right now, if Sweden would, for example, ratify the ILO Convention, what would that mean? It would mean that basically only the reindeer herders would have a strengthened position. But it's a very infected discussion going on within Sami society today, with two sides very clearly divided by history and the state policy.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Other questions, please.
Thank you for a very interesting presentation. I'm interested in what happens with the reindeer in relationship to the Sami, and whether or not there are additional state protections, legislature policies related to the preservation and protection of the reindeer, or if that is fully embedded within the Reindeer Husbandry Act and other acts that are connected to the Sami, and if there is something separate from that legislation, how does that affect and influence the rights of the Sami in relation to the reindeer?
When reindeer herding kind of started to be developed as a big Sami livelihood and industry from about 1600s and onwards, there's a differing opinion on when it happened. But what happened was that all wild reindeer was eventually wiped out in Sweden. So we only have these domesticated reindeer. So there are no legislation outside of the Reindeer Herding Act that really kind of talks about this issue. So it's this is the act that regulates the reindeers. Of course, we have acts concerning cruelty to animals, regulations concerning transportation of animals and things like that. And especially the Swedish membership in the EU the last two decades have kind of become an issue because of the industrial exploitation of Sapmi, of the Sami area. Transportation via trucks and lorries is something that you have to do today to be able to move from winter grazing land to summer grazing land, for example. And that the EU regulation of this is something that has been complicating the issue for the herders. So there are different kind of legislation that affects herding, but basically the big one is about reindeer herding itself. But then we have the act about preservation of the big predators, which also is something that's very negatively affecting the herders and their rights, because they're not allowed to shoot the bear if it's close to a herd. They're not allowed to shoot a wolf if it's close to a herd. They're only allowed to shoot them more or less if they're in the act of actually killing reindeer. And of course, you're not allowed to carry a gun any way you like in Sweden, so you're not supposed to have a gun with you if you go out to check your herd. So it's a very complex situation with a lot of legislation that affects herding and the herders, but nothing that really speaks specifically about reindeers.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but Norway has a slightly larger population than Sweden of the Sami people.
Yep, that's true.
I wondered how much cooperation is between the Sami organizations in Sweden and Norway and Finland. I know I've seen that circular flag. Mm. But I just wonder how much cooperation
there is. Well, there is very much cooperation actually going on especially between the Sami in Sweden, Norway, and Finland. There is cooperation with the Sami in Russia as well, but they are in a much weaker position. But we have a cooperation between the non-governmental organizations through what's called the Sami Council. And that's an organization that was formed in 1956 or 59, it was formed, and it's still working today, and it's an important non-governmental voice for the Sami. And then we have a Sami parliament in Norway, Sweden, and Finland, and they have a collaboration as well between the parliaments, a kind of a parliamentary council that meets a couple of times each year. It will meet the next time in February in 2017, I think. So there is a lot of collaboration and cooperation going on, and this also has long historical roots because, you saw the map, you know Sweden and Norway and Finland are kind of north-south in how the countries are placed, but Sami cultural areas go east-west, so they cross the borders. So you have South Sami in Norway and in Sweden. You have Lule Sami in Norway and Sweden. You have North Sami in Norway, Sweden, and Finland. And then you have some smaller Sami languages and cultural areas only within one of the states that hold the Sami territory. So it's a very complex picture, but collaboration across the borders have always been a natural point of for the Sami society, since that's where they have the other guys who speak their language, for example. That's where they have family.
Thank you so much, Patrik. I think you managed their livelihood is sort of siloed. You know, either you rent there or it's like you don't live an organic life. It felt very choking or suffocating, even as a listener to this presentation. And it entirely has to exist in this nation state colonial structure. And I wonder, I keep wondering that the indigenous people, the Sami people on the ground, what is it like? There's got to be some activism that it exists outside of this colonial nation state logic. Because court cases only tell us this much. But people live, and they have to live. So would you be able to share some of what they do?
Yeah. And if it's definitely, I mean, the way Sami is defined is the state definition. That's the case in Sweden right now today with the legislation. But there is a very strong activism, and it's a growing activism among especially young Sami in the Nordic countries today. And the social media is a very important tool. They're part of a joint Sami activism, and at the same time they're part of a huge international indigenous network and activism. So a lot of Sami are very outspoken. We have a lot of young artists, singers, that are very, very strong. And they are trying to decolonize Swedish society. They're trying to decolonize Swedish universities. They're trying to decolonize Swedish minds. And this is something, a movement that has a few years now, and it's still growing, and I think it's going to be very interesting to see what happens with that. But it's more outside of the organized framework, but there is a very, very huge strength within this movement.
Yeah, one last question, and then we'll have time at the end too for questions later on.
Please. I would also just want to offer, it sounds very similar to the situation in the United States where the Department of Interior, on the branch of acknowledgement recognition, when you're going through your federal recognition process, will ask a tribe, have historically asked tribes, what is your blood quantum for enrollment? What they don't tell tribes is, by the way, you don't have to have one. They'll tell you that. You just say, what is it? And so tribes have made the assumption that you have to have a blood quantum. The only race of people on this continent that have to have that. And the only other creatures are dogs for breeding and racehorses. And what is your blood quantum? And so what happens then is that ultimately, if a tribe sets a blood quantum of, say, 50%, 25%, what have you, and you find situations where tribes, you have someone where that person is an enrolled citizen of tribe X, and their children are, but their grandchildren are not. And so by the tribe's own definition, the tribe makes itself extinct, and then the government gets to say, you made these rules. So I would be cautious of having groups in parliament that are Sami, that are part of the government, that are going along with the establishment of these rules, because then parliament gets to say, oh, we included you, and you made these rules, and
It's a big problem.
It's an old trick.
And it's a big problem. I mean, there are a lot of Sami who cannot be registered to vote for the Sami parliament.
Old trick.
And their children won't be able to vote, and their grandchildren, and so on. So it's a big problem. Yes, I agree. Thank you.